What's up, scholars? This is Caden with Black Books Animated. Today we're going to be doing a review of The Souls of Black Folks by W.E.B. Du Bois. If you haven't already, please smash that like button and subscribe to the channel. William Edward Burghardt Du Bois was born on February 23, 1868 in Great Barrington, Massachusetts, and died on August 27, 1963, at the ripe old age of 95. He was an American sociologist, socialist, historian, civil rights activist, and Pan-Africanist. After completing graduate work at the University of Berlin and Harvard, where he was the first African American to earn a doctorate, he became a professor of history, sociology, and economics at Atlanta University. In this work, Du Bois argues that the problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. The Negro is born with his second sight. It is a peculiar sensation, this double consciousness, this sense of always looking at oneself through the eyes of others, of measuring one's soul by the tape of a world that looks on in amused contempt and pity. One ever feels his two-ness, an American, a Negro, two souls, two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideals in one dark body, whose dogged strength alone keeps it from being torn asunder. This is why many Black Americans today, even in the 21st century, have both a love and hate relationship with America. They love the land of their birth and will fight and die for it. But at the same time, they hate systemic racism, which is still rampant, which still places little value on Black lives. The nation has not yet found peace from its sins. The freedman has not yet found in freedom his promised land. The Holocaust of war, the terrors of the Ku Klux Klan, the lies of carpetbaggers, the disorganization of industry, and the contradictory advice of friends and foes left the bewildered serf no watchword beyond the old cry for freedom. The opposition of Negro education in the South was at first bitter and showed itself in ashes, insults, and blood. For the South believed an educated Negro to be a dangerous Negro. And the South was not wholly wrong, for education among all kinds of men always has had and always will have an element of danger and revolution, of dissatisfaction and discontent. Nevertheless, men strive to know. Fisk, Atlanta, Howard, and Hampton were founded in these days, and $6 million were expended for educational work, $750,000 of which the freedmen themselves gave of their poverty. According to Du Bois, Booker T. Washington arose essentially the leader not of one race, but of two, a compromise between the South, the North, and the Negro. Naturally, the Negro resented at first bitterly signs of compromise which surrendered their civil and political rights in the South so that they could focus on economic development. The rich and dominating North, however, was not only wary of the race problem, but was investing largely in Southern enterprises and welcomed any method of peaceful cooperation that allowed them to grow rich. Du Bois writes that Mr. Washington thus faces the triple paradox of his career. He is striving nobly to make Negro artisans, businessmen, and property owners, but it is utterly impossible under modern competitive methods for working men and property owners to defend their rights and exist without the rights of suffrage. He insists on thrift and self-respect, but at the same time counsels a silent submission to civic inferiority, such as is bound to sap the manhood of any race in the long run. Thirdly, he advocates common school and industrial training, and appreciates institution of higher learning, but neither the Negro common school nor Tuskegee itself could remain open a day were it not for teachers trained in Negro colleges or trained by their graduates. Black people in the South have often been cheated out of what they have worked hard for. This was a system that took over after slavery. I have seen in the Black Belt of Georgia an ignorant, honest Negro buy and pay for a farm installment three separate times, and then in the face of law and decency, the enterprising white American who sold it to him pocketed money and the deed and left the black man landless to labor on his own land at 30 cents a day. I have seen a black farmer fall in debt to a white storekeeper, and the storekeeper go to his farm and strip it of every single marketable article, mules, plows, stored crops, tools, furniture, bedding, clocks, and all without a sheriff or officer, in the face of the law for the homestead exemption, and without rendering to a single responsible person any account or reckoning. And such proceeding can happen and will happen in any community where a class of ignorant toilers is placed by custom and race prejudice beyond on the pale of sympathy and race brotherhood, so long as the best elements of a community do not feel in duty bound to protect and train and care for the weaker members of their community. They leave them to be preyed upon by these swindlers and rascals. We must accept some of the race prejudice in the South as a fact, deplorable in its intensity, unfortunate in result, and dangerous for the future, but nevertheless a hard fact which only time can erase. We cannot hope, then, in this generation, or for several generations, that the mass of whites can be brought to assume that close, sympathetic, and self-sacrificing leadership of black which their present situation so eloquently demands. Such leadership, such social teaching and example must come from blacks themselves. For some time, men doubted as to whether the Negro could develop such leaders. But today, no one seriously disputes the capability of individual Negroes to assimilate the culture and common sense of modern civilization and to pass it on, to some extent at least, to their fellows. If this is true, then here is the path out of the economic situation. And here is the imperative demand for trained Negroes, leaders of character and intelligence, men of skill, men of light, and leading college-bred men, black captains of industry, and missionaries of culture, men who thoroughly comprehend and know modern civilization, and can take hold of the Negro communities and raise and train them by force or precept and example, deep sympathy, and the inspiration of common blood and ideas. But if such men are to be effective, they must have some power. They must be backed by the best public opinions of these communities. In effect, the African American college should train the talented 10th, who can in turns contribute to the lower education and also act as a liaison in improving race relations. Why some black people don't vote. In the 50s, we were near enough echoes of the French Revolution to believe pretty thoroughly in universal suffrage. We argued as we thought then rather logically that no social class was so good, so true, and so disinterested as to be trusted wholly with the political destiny of its neighbors. That in every state, the best arbiters of their own welfare are the persons directly affected. Consequently, that it is only by arming every hand with a ballot, with the right to have a voice in the policy of the state, that the greatest good to the greatest number could be attained. To be sure, there were objections to these arguments, but we thought we had answered them tersely and convincingly. If someone complained of the ignorance of voters, we answered, educate them. If another complained of their venality, we replied, disenfranchise them or put them in jail. And finally, to men who feared demagogues and natural perversity of some human beings, we insisted that time and bitter experience would teach the most hard-headed. It was at this time that the question of the Negro suffrage in the South was raised. Here was a defenseless people suddenly made free. How were they to be protected from those who did not believe in their freedom and were determined to thwart it? Not by force, said the North. Not by government guardianship, said the South. Then by the ballot, the sole legitimate defense of a free people, said the common sense of the nation. No one thought at the time that the ex-slave could use the ballot intelligently or very effectively, but they did think that the possession of so great power by a great class in the nation would compel their fellows to educate this class to intelligent use. Meantime, new thought came to the nation. The inevitable period of moral retrogression and political trickery that ever flows in the wake of a war overtook. So flagrant became the political scandals that reputable men began to leave politics alone, and politics consequently became disreputable. In this state of mind, it became easy to wink at the suppression of the Negro vote in the South, and to advise self-respecting Negroes to leave politics entirely alone. The decent and reputable citizens of the North who neglected their own civic duties grew hilarious over the exaggerated importance with which the Negro regarded the franchise. Thus, it easily happened that more and more the better class of Negroes followed the advice from abroad and the pressure from home and took no further interest in politics, leaving to the careless and the venal of their race the exercise of their right as voters. The black vote that still remained was not trained and educated, but further debauched by open and unblushing bribery, or force and fraud, until the Negro voters were thoroughly inoculated with the idea that politics was a method of private gain by disreputable means. In this day, when we are striving for a renaissance of civic virtue, what are we going to say to the black voters of the South? Are we going to tell them still that politics is a disreputable and useless form of human activity? Are we going to induce the best class of Negroes to take less and less interest in government and to give up their right to take such an interest without a protest? Now, is this a minor matter which has no influence on the question of the industrial and intellectual development of Negroes? Can we establish a mass of black laborers and artisans and landowners in the South who, by law and public opinion, have absolutely no voice in shaping the law under which they live and work? Can a modern organization of industry, assuming as it does free democratic government and the power and ability of the laboring class to compel respect for their welfare, can this system be carried out in the South when half its laboring force is voiceless in public counsel and powerless in its own defense? Today, the black man of the South has almost nothing to say as to how much he shall be taxed, or how those taxes shall be expended, as to who shall execute the law, and how they shall do it, as to who shall make the laws, and how they shall be made. Daily, the Negro is coming more and more to look upon the law and justice not as protecting safeguards, but as a source of humiliation and oppression. The laws are made by men who have little interest in him. They are executed by men who have absolutely no motive for treating the black people with courtesy or consideration. And finally, the accused lawbreaker is tried, not by his peers, but by too often by men who would rather punish 10 innocent Negroes than let one guilty one escape. We see highlighted here Du Bois' main objection to Booker T. Washington. If the Negro does not have rights, he cannot protect the economic gains that he makes. Black leadership is also a key to black success for Du Bois. It is what he considers the talented tent, a group of highly educated Negroes who would put their people first. Finally, black people of this time have been taught not to vote because the system that they were under have always been oppressive, but voting is still a right that is worthy to exercise. Thank you for watching. This was a brief review of The Souls of Black Folks by W.E.B. Du Bois. If you haven't already, please smash that like button and subscribe to the channel. Have a blessed day, and like I always say, remember to live your best life.